Ladies and gentlemen, welcome again to the Sun Hung Kai Properties Nobel Laureate's Distinguished Lectures. Without further delay, may I first invite Professor Kenneth Yang to give a brief introduction to our next distinguished speaker, Professor Yancheng Lin. Professor Yang, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, our second speaker today is Professor Yancheng Lin. He needs very little introduction to an audience in Hong Kong, so I should perhaps take a few minutes to try to place his work in perspective. Earlier today, I told you that matter is made of 12 things, 6 quarks and 6 leptons. If that was all, nature and life would not be very interesting, because all these particles would simply float around, not doing very much of anything. They need to come together to form nuclei, and then in turn, atoms and molecules, and finally, cells and life. And they come together, they can come together, only because they interact, and they only interact through gluons. And gluons are the quanta of Yang-Mills gauge theory, which now unifies the strong, the electromagnetic, and the weak interactions. The gluons are the 13th constituent that I referred to earlier. A major search is now on for the 14th, the Higgs, which is believed to be the origin of mass. Yang-Mills theory was invented in 1954, a theory so much ahead of its time that it received relatively little attention for about 20 years. But it now stands at the very heart of theoretical physics. However, Professor Yang received his Nobel Prize for something else, another achievement just as important, namely the discovery that parity is not conserved. This work was done in 1956 and very unusually was recognized with a Nobel Prize within just 1 year. Yang Zhenying shared the 1957 Nobel Prize for Physics with Li Zhendao. This year is the 50th anniversary of that prize, the first one to be awarded to Chinese scientists. I will not tell you much about parity non-conservation because Professor Yang will do so very shortly, except I want to say that it would not be possible to understand the 3 neutral leptons without parity non-conservation. It would, however, be appropriate for me to take a minute or two to tell you briefly about Professor Yang's association with the Chinese University of Hong Kong and how we have all benefited from his wisdom. Professor Yang first lectured at the Chinese University of Hong Kong in 1964, very soon after the establishment of this university. The lecture was actually on very much the same topic as that today, but I suppose after 43 years, it is all right to repeat the topic with a renewed perspective. On a personal note, I have to say I'm privileged to be in the audience on both occasions. In 1982, Professor Yang was made an honorary professor at CUHK, and then in 1986, he became a distinguished professor at large. In that role, he has given many lectures here, including a regular course on theoretical physics for the physics department, both last year and this year. He was conferred the degree of Doctor of Science honoris causa by the Chinese University of Hong Kong in 1997, and in 1999, Professor Yang very kindly donated to CUHK his manuscripts and his papers, as well as his medals, including the Nobel Medal. And some of the material from the CN Yang archive is on display in the gallery upstairs, including, I'm told, the Nobel Prize Medal, and you are invited to visit the exhibition after the lecture. This is an auspicious time for Professor Yang to give this particular lecture. It is an auspicious year, exactly 50 years since that Nobel Prize, and the year in which Professor Yang celebrates his 85th birthday. It is an auspicious month, for it was on 1st October that Professor Yang was born, and also exactly on 1st October that both the Yang-Mills paper and the parity paper were published, respectively in 54 and 56. It is even an auspicious week, because it was exactly during this very week in October 1957 that the Nobel Prize was announced, causing a great excitement in 1957 about parity non-conservation. And that is exactly Professor Yang's lecture title today. Let us welcome Professor Yang Zhenying.
Thank you. It is a great pleasure for me to give this lecture at the Chinese University. I've had, as Professor Kenneth Yang just told you, had long association with this university. In early January 1957, Professor C.S. Wu announced that her experiment had shown that parity is not conserved in beta decay. This is a photograph of Ms. Wu, taken a few years after her earth-shaking experiment. Her famous paper was in preprint form at that time, at the time that she made the announcement. It was officially published a month later in mid-February, and that date was important because the Nobel Prize nomination had to be before February the 1st, and her paper missed that. This is a copy of her paper in the Physical Review. It reads, "Experimental test of parity conservation in beta decay." It was co-authored by C.S. Wu with three physicists who were experts in low temperature physics at the Bureau of Standards in Washington, D.C. The lower right corner of this page shows the main part of her equipment. In the meantime, news spread like wildfire in the world of physicists. At the annual meeting of the American Physical Society on February 2nd, at the New Yorker Hotel. It was later described that the largest hall normally at our disposal was occupied by so immense a crowd that some of its members did everything but hang from the chandeliers. That 1957 excitement among physicists was exceeded only 40 years later in the high-temperature superconductivity Woodstock meeting of 1997. In fact, it is generally recognized that the 57 excitement and the 97 excitement were the two greatest excitement in physics after the Second World War. What I would attempt to do now is to describe to you the background and some reactions to Ms. Wu's experiment. Experiments in physics were small in scale before World War II. Typical example is Thomson's 1897 apparatus. Professor Pearl had referred to this experiment of Thomson's, which discovered the electron. Before 1897, it was not known that there was a small particle called the electron. And Thomson discovered the electron with this very small piece of equipment. This piece is now in the British Museum. After World War II, nuclear physics became a very hot field of research. Larger and larger accelerators were built in order to explore the frontiers in nuclear physics and later elementary particle physics. This is the first large accelerator called Cosmotron built at the Brookhaven National Laboratory in 1952. It's now dismantled. It reached the highest energy at that time available in the laboratory. It was 3 billion electron volts. This is a photograph of the currently largest laboratory in the world, called CERN at Geneva, Switzerland. At the lower left corner is the International Airport of Geneva. And you see that the big ring. That big ring is an underground tunnel, and particles are accelerated in that big tunnel. In the far distance is the Jura Mountain of France. With these accelerators and with the cosmic ray experiments, many new kinds of elementary particles previously unknown were discovered. After Thomson's discovery of 1897, people realized that there were, beyond the electron, other elementary particles which are the fundamental constituents of all matter. And with these accelerators, new particles were discovered, previously unknown. For example, one of the discoveries in the 1940s was the Pi meson. The Pi meson comes up from the top, and at that corner, it disintegrates into two particles, one of which is not charged and is not visible. And the other particle is called mu. It goes to the right on this diagram. This whole technology was called a photographic immersion. Photographic immersion is like the film that you use for taking photographs, but it's a super sensitive kind of immersion, which was developed in Great Britain by Ilford after the Second World War. With this new technology, it was possible to observe these minute particles if they are charged. And the particle pi, which comes in from the top, is positively charged. The decay product, which you see here, is called mu, is also charged. The other decay product, question mark here, is neutral and is not visible with this technology. The particle pi had been predicted in 1937 by the Japanese theoretical physicist Yukawa, Tong Chuan Shoushu. And that was a great discovery which earned Yukawa a Nobel Prize in 1949. Discovery of pi and its daughter mu caused great excitement in 1947. But then, in the next few years, several additional particles were discovered. They were unexpected, so they were called strange particles. And the number of strange particles increased in the next few years. For example, a particle called K was discovered. This K particle comes from the right, and it goes to that point where it disintegrates into three particles, and they were identified as pi plus, pi plus, and pi minus. The pi plus and pi plus are, when pi plus goes down to the southeast, another pi plus goes to the west, but the pi minus goes on top. How do we know it's a pi minus? Because at the point B, it collides with an atom of the immersion, and the fragments come out, and those are those two big tracks. Such kind of immersion pictures were very, very important in the late 40s, because with this kind of technology, many new strange particles were discovered. For the next 15 years, 1950 to 1965, fundamental physics was chiefly occupied with identifying these strange particles and studying their properties. What are the properties that people were concentrating on? Whether they are charged, plus, minus, or neutral. Their masses, how they decay, and how long does it take before they decay. Whether they have spin. It was known since the 1920s that every elementary particle, or most elementary particle, is spinning, and the spinning value is an integral multiple of certain fundamental units. This is one of the great discoveries of quantum mechanics. So the spin of a particle becomes a very important characteristic of that particle. So these were the properties that were cataloged and studied and intensively analyzed in those years. For example, by 1961, this is a diagram that I drew later in 1962 of the known particles at that time. The vertical scale is the mass, so those on top are heavier than those at the bottom. And there were three categories of particles, so they were in three compartments. And you see that the K particles complex were on the right side. So such kind of studies dominated the whole field of fundamental physics around that time. The K particle had first been called tau, to distinguish from the theta particle. There was another particle, originally also called tau K, but later changed into theta. Theta is a positively charged particle which disintegrates into a pi plus and a pi zero. Tau and theta were thought at first to be totally unrelated particles because their signatures were different. One decays into two particles, the other decay into three particles. So they were given different names. But then other K particles were discovered, so there was great confusion. So at one time, there was the names K pi 2, that means a K which disintegrates into two pis, K pi 3, that means a K which decays into three pis, K mu 2, it means a K which decays into two particles, one of which is a mu, et cetera, et cetera. All this terminology were very confusing for quite a number of years. And one of the dominant questions was, were they the same particle or were they all different? There was also great certainty in this type of research. For example, Gell-Mann theoretically predicted there should be two kinds of K0. Just based on the catalog of these particles and based on fundamental principles in physics, Gell-Mann predicted that there should be two kinds of K0. It's a dramatic prediction theoretically, and it was confirmed within a couple of years. This was one of the reasons that Gell-Mann later got the Nobel Prize. This is a picture of Murray Gell-Mann. He is one of the wonder child of American society. Now I come to the theta tau puzzle. Between 1954 and 1957, the hottest debate was about the theta tau puzzle. We already said that there was a particle previously called K, later became theta, which decays into two pis. There was another particle which was called tau, which decays into three pis. One finds, on the one hand, that more and more precise experiments show that theta and tau have the same masses, to only within a few percent, and have very comparable longevity. Their decay rate are approximately the same. Now, most particles have widely different masses and lifetimes. So for two particles to have such closely identical, almost identical masses, identical to within the experimental errors, and to have comparable longevities was a very strange thing. So naturally, it was thought that it could be one particle. So there seemed to be the same particle with two different ways of decay. Sometimes it decays into two pis, sometimes it decays into three pis. And that kind of a possibility of two modes of decay was very common. So this is a natural conclusion that the theta and tau were the same particle. But on the other hand, it was known that each particle has a parity. Parity is a fundamental property of each of these particles, like spin, but it's more subtle. And there was a fundamental law. The fundamental law says conservation of parity. According to that law, it says that if a particle disintegrates, its own parity must be equal to the parity of the decay products, which says in decays, parity cannot change. Now, the three types of pi's, pi plus, pi zero, pi minus, all have parity of minus one. Theta decays into pi plus, pi zero. The parity for a multi-particle system is multiplicative. So pi plus, pi minus, each contribute minus one to the parity. So the total parity of pi plus pi zero is minus one squared, which is plus one. So that says, according to parity conservation, that theta must have parity plus one. On the other hand, tau decays into three pi's. Each of them contributes a minus one. Minus one to the cube power is minus one. So tau plus seems to have parity minus one. I said seems. It's because there is some complication. We have not talked about some subtlety. When we say the three pi mesons have parity, which is the product of three parities, there is a condition for that to be correct. Namely, that it does not have some complication called orbital parity. Most likely because some details about tau decay had to be examined to rule out orbital contribution to parity. The pi, minus one times minus one times minus one is always there. But there could be some additional parity contribution called orbital parity. And therefore, the question, the burning question in those 2 years was, is there an orbital parity? For those people who advocate that there's an orbital parity, they said this is natural. You just put another odd parity, orbital parity, then you have minus one to the fourth power, which is plus one, and therefore theta and tau would become the same particle. However, to rule out the orbital parity, you need more study. And that study was made by a distinguished theoretical physicist named Dalitz. And he invented what was called the Dalitz plot. The Dalitz plot consists of more or less the following. For every event that you see of a tau decay, which has three pions, three pi's going out, he was able to plot it as one point in Dalitz's diagram. Now, when you have hundreds of those particles, you have those decays, you have such a diagram like this. And if you study this in detail, if the distribution of these points is uniform, that means there is no parity contribution by orbital parity. So that was the great question for 2 years. And Dalitz was the one who made the greatest contribution to the sphere. This is a picture of Dalitz, who unfortunately passed away last year. This was a picture taken in 2002 in Tsinghua University at the celebration of my 80th birthday. He was still quite robust, and I was very, very pleased that he came to that conference. At the International Conference on High Energy Physics, April 3rd to 6th, 1956, at Rochester in New York State, the most important conference in physics in the 1950s, Dalitz summarized the works of the previous 2 years, showing that the hundreds of tau decays studied gave a uniform distribution in the Dalitz plot. That was the plot that I showed you a few minutes ago. Hence, no orbital parity. Hence, tau does have parity of minus one, hence contradiction. Hence, by parity conservation, theta and tau cannot be the same particle. One has parity plus one, one has parity minus one, hence puzzle. This is the definition of the theta tau puzzle. But of course, once this puzzle becomes the focus of attention, many people would say that, hey, perhaps parity, could parity be not conserved? So in the corridors at coffee, there was always somebody who would say, oh, it's very simple. Just say parity is not conserved. But immediately he would be shouted down because there were three reasons why people believed in parity conservation. And these were deep-rooted beliefs which nobody believed at that time should be shaken. First, parity conservation means physical universe is right-left symmetrical. Parity conservation is merely just a technical jargon which translated into daily language says nothing more and nothing less than that right and left are symmetrical. Now, what is meant by right-left symmetrical? We know not that we are not symmetrical. Our heart are on the left side. But when physicists say that right and left are symmetrical, the meaning is the following. If you create my mirror image with his heart on the right side, everything is reversed. Then, according to parity conservation, he and I should be able to behave exactly the same. Or let's make it more, perhaps make it clearer. If you produce a car, which is the mirror image of your car, in Hong Kong, the driver sits on the right side. So the mirror image car would have the driver sitting on the left side, and the gasoline pedals and the brakes would also be reversed. According to laws of physics, according to parity conservation, if you depress the two cars' gas pedal by the same amount, the two should go at the same speed. That is meant by parity conservation or right-left symmetry. This seems a priori indisputable, and it is also borne out by Newton's equations and Maxwell's equations. It can be proved that Newton's equations and Maxwell's equations do observe right-left symmetry. So they become sort of deeply rooted in the fundamental structure of physics. Secondly, right-left symmetry has great intuitive and aesthetic appeal, obviously. Third, after the 1920s and 1930s, in quantum mechanics, it was shown that parity is accurately conserved in atomic physics. And indeed, that conservation became a powerful tool used effectively in theoretical and experimental research. In other words, after quantum mechanics was discovered in the 1920s, parity conservation became a tool for studying atoms and molecules. And if you now say that parity is not conserved, you are destroying all those accumulated wisdom. So of course, people were reluctant to entertain that idea. And the importance of parity conservation was first noticed in atomic and molecular physics, then in nuclear physics, then in nuclear reactions. In all of these areas, in particular, in hundreds of beta decay experiments, selection and intensity rules involving parity conservation were found to be in good agreement with experiments. It has become such a useful tool, it becomes automatically assumed to be universally correct. And that was one of the reasons why people was reluctant to give up parity conservation. Thus, it was inconceivable that parity can be not conserved. I wrote in 1957, after parity conservation was found to be not universally correct, I wrote, the situation physicists found themselves in was like that of a man in a dark room groping for an exit. Sorry, this was a speech I made in 1956, before Wu's experiment. He knew there is a door somewhere, but in which direction? Next, let's come to the three key developments which gave rise to the proposal that maybe one should test parity conservation in beta decay. The first important breakthrough point was the idea that maybe for most forces, parity conserved, but not for some forces. But for some forces, it is not conserved. Most forces means the usual chemical forces, electromagnetic forces, because chemical forces and electromagnetic forces observe Newton's and Maxwell's and quantum mechanical laws. All of these respect the right-left symmetry. So that's those parity conservation for those situations cannot be questioned. But maybe for some forces, such as beta decay, it was not. Beta decay is a much weaker force than chemical forces, electromagnetic forces, and nuclear forces. There's a category of forces called weak forces, which includes beta decay. In fact, I'm sure you all know that around the turn of the century, in 1900, radioactivity was discovered. Radioactivity was a very weak force, but it turns out to be of tremendous importance, not only for research, but today we know it's one of the important components of radiation therapy. But it was already recognized in the 1940s and 50s that this radiation, radioactivity forces was much weaker. So collectively, they were called weak forces. So the first idea was that maybe for the better known forces, parity is conserved. But for the weak forces, it may not be. This led to a detailed examination of parity conservation in weak interactions, in particular in beta decay. In beta decay, there had been hundreds of experiments which used the concept of parity conservation, and so that everybody had regarded that parity conservation was a well-known, settled subject in beta decay. But the idea that Lee and I got in the summer of 1956 was that let us re-examine these beta decay experiments and see whether indeed the previous beta experiments had proved that parity is conserved in beta decay. After lengthy calculations of five different types of beta decay experiments, we reached the surprising conclusion that all previous experiments in beta decay had nothing to do with parity conservation. That is to say, parity conservation was up to then untested in beta decay. Now you would ask, if that is the case, why wasn't that realized before? This is because people were fooled by the success of the parity rules. The parity rules indeed was correct and was experimentally useful and experimentally extensively used. But it turns out, after these calculations, they have nothing to do with the fundamental, the usefulness of the parity rules. In fact, did not show that the right-left was symmetrical. This was a great revelation to us. So Lee and I then suggested in the summer of 56 several experiments to test parity conservation in beta decay and in other weak interactions. I wrote later in 1957, after Wu's experiment was already performed, The fact that parity conservation in the weak interaction was believed for so long without experimental support was very startling. But what was more startling was the prospect that a space-time symmetry law, which the physicists had learned so well, may be violated. The symmetry law is one of the cornerstones of the fundamental structure of theoretical physics today. To say that there's some flaw in the symmetry was, of course, something which nobody wanted to entertain. This prospect did not appear to us. Rather, we were, so to speak, driven to it through frustration with the various other efforts of understanding the theta-tau puzzle that had been made. This was what I wrote later in 1957. The paper by Lee and me was submitted to the Physical Review on June the 22nd, 1956. It was published, as Professor Young told you, on October the 1st. This is the title page of the manuscript. The title was, Is parity conserved in weak interactions? When it came out, the title has been changed. The title became Question of Parity Conservation in Weak Interactions. Why the change? Because the editor of the Physical Review was a distinguished physicist one generation older than I, by the name of Goldschmidt, and he ruled rather obstinately that there should not be a question mark in the title of any paper, so it became this. I remembered I had argued with him that the one with the question mark is more conveys more impression, but to no avail. Reaction, general disbelief. The formidable Pauli. Pauli was born in the year 1900. He was a heavyset person who was who always made the sarcastic remarks. So we young people were all very much afraid of him because he would at every moment try to poke holes into your ideas. One famous story about him was a young man wrote a theoretical paper and gave it to Professor Pauli to look at. Pauli looked at it for 2 days. The young man came back and said, what's your reaction? Pauli said, this paper is not even wrong. And the formidable Pauli wrote, I do not believe that the Lord is a weak left-hander. And I'm ready to bet a very high sum that the experiment will give symmetric angular distribution of the electrons. That means parity is conserved. He did offer to make that bet. But when the experiment showed that he was wrong, he wrote to Weisskopf, fortunately, nobody bet with me. If somebody had, it would ruin me financially. This way, I only lose some prestige, which I can afford. This is a picture of Professor Pauli. Feynman, a brilliant theoretical physicist, then 36 years old, made a bet that parity is conserved at the overwhelming odds of 50 to 1. When parity was found to be not conserved, he wrote a check for $50. The check was not cashed, it's framed and hanged somewhere. Felix Bloch, who had won the Nobel Prize for nuclear magnetic resonance, which is the technology that led later to the magnetic, to MRI, said he would eat his hat if parity is not conserved. I believe Bloch was the first Nobel Prize winner at Stanford. Lee and I felt we had pointed out an important fact in 1956, namely the lack of experimental proof that parity is conserved in weak interactions. But we do not believe that parity is indeed non-conserved in any interactions. In other words, we believed parity is conserved, but we believe that we proposed that one should do an experiment to test it because it has not been tested up to that point. Not believing that parity could be non-conserved, we therefore, after our paper was submitted in June, we turned our main attention to another field of physics, statistical mechanics. The fact that we abandoned this parity field and go into another field was indicative, of course, of the fact that we didn't bet on parity non-conservation. In the meantime, most experimental physicists did not want to tackle the experiments we had suggested because they felt the experiments we suggested were all difficult. We suggested 5 types of experiment. None of them was easy. And doing them would only confirm what everyone already knew was true, namely, parity is conserved. So they were not worth doing. After all, if you do an experiment which came out with somebody with something which everybody says they knew and they believed, so that's not a big deal. So they didn't want to do the experiment. But Wu had deeper strategic perception. This, in my opinion, is her greatness. She also did not fear parity could be non-conserved. She was a friend and admirer of the great Pauli, and Pauli had said that it couldn't be parity is not conserved. But she felt the fundamental law of nature must be tested experimentally. So I later had said that Wu Jianqiong du ju hui yan. And that was her greatness. She went about doing it, and it was a difficult experiment. She was a great beta decay physicist. But the experiment needed a combination of that technology with low temperature technology. So she recruited 4 low temperature physicists from the Bureau of Standards in Washington, D.C. to collaborate on one of the experiments we had suggested, namely, the beta decay of polarized radioactive cobalt-60. That cobalt-60 beta decay was well known. It just happened that a few years before that, people had developed the technology to polarize nuclei. So cobalt-60 can be polarized, and in fact, it can be polarized at the Bureau of Standards. So Ms. Wu called up Ambler and proposed a collaboration, and that collaboration resulted in the next 5 years, Ms. Wu's shuttling between New York City and Washington, D.C. They had many difficulties. Since beta decay and low temperature were 2 new technologies which had not yet been brought together in one experiment, many tactical problems had to be solved. For example, the low temperature required them to make a big crystal to hold the cobalt-60 sample. And so therefore, they had to learn the technology of making big crystals. Now, physicists usually do not try to make big crystals. So they had to consult their chemist friends about how to make big crystals. In fact, Ms. Wu later said that she went to the Columbia Library and found a old book covered with dust which told about how to make big crystals. After 3 weeks of frustrating struggle, Wu and her Columbia students finally succeeded in making a crystal of about 1 centimeter size, which is quite large, beautiful like a diamond. And she later wrote, The day when I brought that crystal to Washington, I was the happiest and proudest person in the world. That sort of describes the kind of anxiety and enthusiasm and persistence that permeated the atmosphere of the whole experiment. So that resulted in this paper. And you see the equipment on the right is a tube. And that crystal, that the 1 centimeter size crystal with the cobalt 60 on the surface is at the bottom of that tube. And this piece of equipment is now in the Smithsonian Institute in Washington. In this diagram, that tube is in the center. This big kind of thing on the bottom is a magnet. The magnet is the machinery with which they produced the low temperature. The temperature was near minus 273 degrees centigrade. It was near absolute zero. So it was a very new technology that she had to adapt to beta decay experiments in order to do the experiment. After Wu announced that their experiment had shown parity to be not conserved in beta decay, on January the 5th, 1957, I cabled to Robert Oppenheimer, who was the director of the Institute for Advanced Study, where I was a professor. He was in the Caribbean, in the Virgin Islands. My telegram said, Wu's experiment yielding large asymmetry showing G equal to G prime stop. Therefore, neutrino is a two-component wave function stop. It is a pure screw. Greetings, Frank. I have lost the return cable that Oppenheimer sent me, but I had written down his answer at the bottom. Answer from J. Robert Oppenheimer. Walked through door, greetings. He was referring to the dark room where we were looking for a door of a speech that I made in 1956. There was a press release in the middle of 1957, January 1957, and the next day that appeared as on the front page of the New York Times. Basic concept in physics is reported upset in tests. The dam has cracked. Physicists rushed test parity conservation in various weak interactions. Over the next 5 years, hundreds of such experiments were performed, confirming the fact that indeed parity non-conservation is a general characteristic of all weak interactions. You would ask why? I have to report that parity non-conservation has now been studied for the last 50 years, and physicists now understand a lot of the details, but do not understand, cannot answer the question why. There is no fundamental idea about why nature is constructed such that for most of the interactions, right and left are symmetrical, but for this type of weak interactions, right and left are not symmetrical. And in fact, for all this type, it's not symmetrical. This is perhaps a big problem left for the next few generations of physicists. Later developments. Wu's experiment opened the door to many avenues of research in subsequent years. First, it elevated symmetry to a central concept in formulating fundamental theories, and there were many new formulations, most of which were not successful. But it does push the concept of symmetry in fundamental physics into a central role, and that remains the perhaps the most important, one of the most important themes of today's fundamental physics. Two, detailed understanding of discrete symmetries. P stands for parity. It turns out that there are two other kinds of so-called discrete symmetries called charge conjugation and time reversal, including CP non-conservation, which won the 1980 Nobel Prize. Three, understanding of the properties of the elusive particle, the neutrino. I had to refer to the neutrino being a screw in my cable to Oppenheimer. It turned out the neutrino is a very strange particle, and it remains very strange today. And subsequent discoveries about the neutrino has led to three Nobel Prizes. There was 1988 two neutrino experiment. At the time of 1957, there was only one neutrino known. But later on, it turns out that there has to be two neutrinos, and that won a Nobel Prize in 1988, although the experiment was done in the 1960s. In 1995, there was another neutrino discovered, and that was one of the great contributions of Professor Martin Pohl, who won the 1995 Nobel Prize. In 2002, the Japanese physicist found a phenomena called neutrino oscillation. The three different kinds of neutrinos can oscillate between themselves. This is a phenomena which I absolutely refused to believe could be the case until I was shown wrong. It remains one of the great mysteries. If God created three neutrinos, okay, why make them oscillate among each other? Nobody knows the answer. That remains another fundamental problem for the next generations of physicists. But Wu never received the Nobel Prize, which he richly deserved. Why? This is a constant topic of conversation among physicists. One of the reasons could be that her experiment was published in February, after the deadline. But that argument is not quite waterproof, because, okay, why the rush? Why not? In other words, in 1957, the Nobel Committee, in awarding the Nobel Prize to Li and me, they could not include Wu, because Wu's experiment was not published before the deadline for that prize. But why don't they wait a year? Then they could give it to the three of us. So this is a miracle which nobody has yet resolved. However, I understand that the historians of science could ask the Nobel Committee 50 years after the decision to show them the documents about the discussion. So maybe soon somebody will do that and clarify what happened. But in any case, the fact in 1957 that Wu, Li, and I were all ethnic Chinese caused lots of comments. In particular, later on, Si Gui, a Nobel Prize winner himself, who was the thesis advisor at Berkeley of C.S. Wu, wrote a semi-popular book about fundamental physics, and he has this paragraph to say. This trio of Chinese physicists shows what China's future contribution to physics could be if that great country overcomes the period of revolutionary conversions and resumes its historic role as one of the leaders of civilization, as witnessed by the early European travelers to their astonishment. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Yan. Thank you, Professor Yan, for sharing your insights with us. Professor Yan has kindly agreed to take a few questions from the floor. May I now invite Professor Kenneth Young to be the moderator of the question and answer session.
Professor Yang, thank you again for a crystal clear lecture as usual. Before I ask for question, I think I have to add a remark so that the audience is not confused. The Tao that Professor Yang mentioned is not the same as the Tao that Professor Pearl discovered. It's just that physicists ran out of letters of the Greek alphabet. Okay, questions.
Where?
Ah, Professor Chen Zivan.
Why the physicist so poor to choose the same letter, Tau?
So the question is, why did physicists use the same letter of the alphabet to denote something different? Your Tau and his Tau.
About the naming of particles, I'll only tell you a story. You know, in the 60s, there was a great discovery which won a Nobel Prize. It's called the J particle. Now, the discoverer of the J particle was Dian Zhaozhong. So there was a rumor that Dian Zhaozhong named it J because J looks like a Din. But Dian Zhaozhong vehemently denied this connection.
Right, other questions?
Professor Yang, I actually have two questions which are not as technical as the previous question. What is it about your upbringing, your beliefs, or the influences at the time that enable you to so-called rock the boat, to dare the devil, that separated you from the rest of, from most of the accomplished scientists at the time? That's my first question. My second question is, actually, before you got to the latter part of your presentation, I spotted that, like, your collaborator and Ms. Wu, they are all ethnic Chinese. What is it about, is that one of the major reasons why she took on the courage to tackle the suggestions you made to actually conduct the experiment?
I think Lee and I, in 1956, were deeply impressed by what had already been known. Knowing that the parity might be at fault, we went back in our minds and asked ourselves, what are the evidence which convince people that parity has to be conserved? In particular, we re-examined Newton's equations, Maxwell's equations, quantum mechanics, and convinced ourselves that structure-wise, they do observe right-left symmetry. And we then looked at the experiments which showed that in those type of forces, experimentally, right and left were symmetrical, and we, in fact, we acquainted ourselves with the accuracy of those type of experiments. Now, after all those are done, the only thing that could be called into question is the weakening actions. So then we made the extensive calculations. The reason that we were able to do this better than other people is partly because I was deeply, I was deeply into beta decay theory already since my graduate thesis days. So knowing the details of what were the beta decay calculations beforehand convinced us that we should redo them more carefully, and that's what we did. And as I said, when we redid this calculation with the possibility of having maybe parity non-conservation thrown into it, the conclusion was surprising. It certainly deeply surprised us and surprised everybody when we wrote about it, namely that the previous belief in beta decay parity conservation was an illusion. In some sense, as I said, we were in a box and we're looking for a door. And we knew there has to be a door because the nature has been operating correctly, although in a strange fashion. So there has to be a reason. And finally, we found it.
Okay, any other questions?
Professor Yang, what makes you that you believe that the low, that the only weak forces will only weak forces will experiment will be non-conserved.
Let me see if I heard it correctly. What made you think that only the in the weak force would parity not be conserved?
What made you think in this way? Why you exclude the strong forces, not electromagnetic forces, but you only suspect this only appears in weak forces?
Why only in the weak
forces? Yeah, what made you think so?
That's a $64,000 question. No answer to that. Yeah, the whole thing is very strange, in fact, because in this cobalt 60 decay, electrons come out. And after the experiment, people learned that the electrons come out in a spiraling, in a left-handed spiral. Now, before Wu's experiment, you would naturally assume when a particle comes out, it's not spiraling. You know, one can make three kinds of rifles. One, the usual rifle in which the bullets would just come out straight. You can make a right-handed rifle in which the bullets would come out spiraling right-handed. The other one is you can make a rifle in which the bullets come out in a left-handed spiral. Now, one's natural assumption is that in a cobalt decay experiment, the electrons would come out non-spiraling. Why God chose to make the electrons come out spiraling, which is the discovery of parity non-conservation, is a puzzle which nobody understands. And as I said, that remains to be resolved by the next generations of physicists.
Right, I'm afraid we have run out of time. Let us all, with a round of applause, thank Professor Yang again. And I thank you for attending. Yes, yeah.